Grammar Girl here. I'm Mignon Fogarty, your friendly guide to the English language. We talk about writing, history, rules, and other cool stuff. Oppenheimer just won 7 Oscars, including Best Picture, and it has people talking about the word nuclear. So we'll talk about that this week. And I'll also talk about CamelCase and a new online use that's made me warm up to it. Here's a listener question.
Hi. Along with the popularity now of the film about Robert Oppenheimer, we're hearing, or rehearing, because we haven't heard it so much until recently, the mispronunciation of the word nuclear as nuclear, even by people who should know a lot better. This drives me crazy. There are some other words who mispronounced in a similar way. For instance, the word jewelry is frequently pronounced as jewelry, and the word realtor is often pronounced as realtor. All of these make me absolutely cringe, and I just wonder if there are any others. Not that I'm really desirous of hearing them, but this to me is a curiosity, and why does anyone speak this way? Thanks.
Great question. So first, the word nuclear comes from nucleus, so it makes sense that it's pronounced the same way. Nucleus comes straight from Latin, where the word meant kernel, but it goes all the way back to Proto-Indo-European, to a root that means nut. Adam Online says the same root gives us the word nougat, which is sweet meat made of almonds and other nuts. So for a science fair or art project, someone should make a sculpture of a nuclear bomb cloud out of nougat. Nuclear bombs are called nuclear because the explosion comes from reactions that happen in the super-dense core, the nucleus of an atom. Now, although it's supposed to be pronounced nuclear, lots of people have been pronouncing it other ways for a long time. And prominent people. George W. Bush is probably the most well-known because he was ridiculed for it. But sources say Presidents Clinton and Eisenhower and Vice President Mondale were also heard to pronounce it nuclear. And I feel like I've just scratched the surface here, too, on prominent people who've pronounced it that way. The nuclear entry at Merriam-Webster says that in addition to the presidents and vice president, the nuclear pronunciation has, quote, been found in widespread use among educated speakers, including scientists, lawyers, professors, congressmen, and U.S. cabinet members, unquote. And they point out that it's not just Americans. British and Canadian people have been heard pronouncing it this way, too. And as the caller noted, nuclear isn't the only word that has this kind of problem. People do a similar thing with jewelry and realtor. Epenthesis and metathesis are words linguists use to describe the kinds of changes you're hearing. In epenthesis, people insert an extra sound into a word, like how Irish and Scottish people sometimes pronounce film as film. That Oppenheimer was quite a film. And people sometimes use epenthesis when they're trying to be funny, too, like when Yogi Bear talks about his picnic basket, or when someone who just graduated jokingly says they're all edumacated now. That A you're hearing in realtor comes from epenthesis. Metathesis, on the other hand, involves the swapping of sounds or syllables within a word, and it's also quite common. For example, did you know that the word bird was originally brid, spelled B-R-I-D? It was metathesis that gave us the modern word bird. In the same way, the word third was originally thread. Metathesis is also why axe competes with ask and why some people say purdy instead of pretty. And here's an interesting piece of metathesis-related trivia I've mentioned before. According to the American Name Society, Oprah Winfrey's actual first name is spelled O-R-P-H-A, Orpah, after the character in the Book of Ruth in the Bible, but her family always pronounced it Oprah. Metathesis is probably what's going on when people say jewelry instead of jewelry, although I've also seen sources say the mispronunciation is the result of apenthesis, inserting the lur sound. It's the same with nuclear. I've seen sources say that nuclear is the result of metathesis, and others say it's apenthesis. They're very similar. But apenthesis and metathesis only describe what's happening with these pronunciations. Why do people do it? Well, the Merriam-Webster Dictionary of English Usage has a pretty straightforward idea. Maybe nuclear is hard to say, and there aren't a lot of other common words with similar sounds to guide people. There aren't none. We have pricklier, likelier, and cocklier, but it's not a lot. On the other hand, we have muscular, spectacular, vernacular, peculiar, particular, binocular, molecular, circular, and more. And those are probably the kinds of words people have more in their minds when they're looking at nuclear and trying to remember how to pronounce it. Especially because, as you may have noticed, all those other words have a Q sound right before the common ending. Muscular, spectacular, just like the mispronunciation nuclear. And nuclear isn't the only non-standard pronunciation for the word either. Merriam-Webster notes that President Jimmy Carter pronounced it with two syllables, nuclear. But in his 2005 book, Going Nuclear, Jeff Nunberg disagrees that nuclear is hard to pronounce. He says, try pronouncing it three times fast. No problem. Nuclear, nuclear, nuclear. He tells a story of, quote, a Pentagon wise guy, unquote, who worked with nukes and pronounced it nuclear on purpose. And he said he only pronounced it that way when he was talking about weapons, not in other phrases, like if he were talking about nuclear families. So it seemed to be some kind of insider joke, or maybe a power play against the engineers he said sometimes gave him a hard time for pronouncing it that way. Pointing out that George W. Bush would have certainly heard the word nuclear pronounced correctly his whole life from his father, George H.W. Bush, who said it the standard way, and during his Ivy League education, Nunberg wonders whether the nuclear pronunciation was something that rubbed off from the Pentagon wise guy types, or if Bush was doing it on purpose to be folksy. It's hard to say. I looked for videos of him saying the word when he was younger and of him talking about nuclear families, but I didn't have any luck. If you come across anything like that, please let me know. I'll end this segment with a couple of fun anecdotes from the nuclear entry in Garner's Modern English Usage. First, apparently in an on-language column in the New York Times Magazine in 2001, William Safire suggested that because so many presidents had mispronounced the word, speechwriters should use the phonetic spelling in speeches. And second, Garner says that in 2012, he asked Bush's chief of staff, Andrew Card, quote, whether the pronunciation of nuclear had ever been discussed in his presence in the Oval Office. And Card answered, endlessly. Thanks again for the question. You know about uppercase and lowercase, but do you know about camel case? Well, even if you don't know the name, you have definitely seen it. Camel case is when letters in the middle of words or a string of words are capitalized. Most often, the capital letters in the middle seem to come from squishing words together that would normally be separated by a space, such as PlayStation and YouTube. But occasionally, the capital letter seems to just pop up at a convenient syllable, like in the band name OutKast that has a capital K in the middle. Camel case gets its name from the capital letter in the middle of the word, looking like the hump of a camel. Now, people disagree about whether it's technically camel case if the first letter of the name is capitalized too. Some people call it camel case either way, but other people call it Pascal case or upper camel case when the first letter of each word is capitalized, including the first letter of the whole thing, like YouTube and PlayStation. and call it lower camel case when the first letter of the whole thing is lowercase, like you see in iPhone and eBay. But I'm just going to call it all camel case today. The name Pascal case, though, is a big clue about where the practice originated. Although the phenomenon can be traced back to at least the 1950s, it gained steam among computer programmers, probably because spaces are disallowed in some programming languages. So a convenient way to highlight multiple words in a file name or a variable was to capitalize the first letter of each squished together word. And more recently, marketers decided it was a way to make a company name look cool. It may have also gotten some gas from domain names, which of course don't have spaces. If you're running it all together in your URL, like quickanddirtytips.com, some people would just go ahead and write the company name the same way without any spaces. But then it's hard to read, so you fix it by capitalizing the first letter of every word. And it's kind of interesting that camel case seems all modern and trendy because writing words without spaces is actually an ancient practice. Words were written that way, all run together without spaces between them, in late classical Latin and classical Greek until at least the 7th or 8th century. Today, aside from the marketing and programming uses that I've talked about in the past, camel case has also become important for people who use screen readers, particularly for hashtags, which by their nature don't have spaces between words. When you write a hashtag in all lowercase, screen readers, which are devices that read digital text out loud, these screen readers can't always tell where the words start and end. And the software reads the hashtag the way it might sound if it was all one long, weird word. For instance, an example created by accessibility expert Adrian Rosselli shows how a screen reader interprets the hashtag harder for all users to read when it's written in all lowercase, instead of using camel case to capitalize the first letter of every word. And it comes out kind of like harder for Osser's toe red, making it much harder to understand than hashtag harder for all users to read with each word capitalized, which allows the screen reader to recognize each word and read it right. And capitalizing each word in a hashtag isn't just for people who use screen readers either. It's easier for everyone to read multi-word hashtags when each word is capitalized, and you don't have to make that extra effort to figure out what each word is. And sometimes it's hard to tell, or at least it can be funny. Big Dog KC, for example, recently told me on Facebook about a company called O'Neill Honda in Overland Park, Kansas, saying their URL, which also appears in lowercase on their license plate frames, is O'NeillHonda.com, which can actually look like one ill Honda, which is, quote, not a good message for the sales staff, but perhaps a promo for the service department, unquote. And after posting a picture of what to me was just a stock art mansion, and then having lots of people from Portland recognize it as the Pittock Mansion in Portland, Oregon, and make comments, I joked that I should switch to doing just mansion content and delighting people in different cities by posting a picture of a new mansion every week. And Scamper on Threads replied, "The Manor Girl would be an unexpected side gig," which in all lowercase is a funny new example of handles that can mean different things depending on the capitalization. Was it the Manor Girl or the man or girl? So when it comes to camel case, don't use it willy-nilly, but do use it for formal company names like PayPal and in hashtags and other places where it helps to make the meaning clear. And finally, here's a fun tidbit about why we call letters uppercase and lowercase. It has to do with actual cases or trays. When compositors set type by hand for letterpress printing with individual metal letters, the big letters are kept in one case, and the little letters are kept in another case. The way the two cases are typically arranged has the big uppercase letters literally in a case on the top. And the lowercase letters are literally in a more convenient lower case or container, since they're used more often. So uppercase and lowercase are just descriptions of where printers put the cases that hold the different letters. Finally, I have a Familect story.
Hi, Mignon. I've been pondering whether to send this, since it doesn't really seem to qualify as the word that my family uses, but only my family uses. Well, it was only used once, other than my mom telling the story. When I was in kindergarten, she had to leave to pick me up and told my sister, 2 years old, to get dressed. And when she asked my sister if she was ready, she said, "I've got one clo on," thinking that the singular of clothes must be clo. And I just decided to send it because you mentioned clothes as being a plural-only noun.
Thanks. That's funny. It kind of reminds me of how people mistakenly think the word kudos is plural, and we'll talk about a kudo. Tell me your Familect. That's what we call words used by your family and only your family. You could leave me a voicemail with your story at 83-321-4GIRL. It's in the show notes, and be sure to tell me the story behind your Familect, because that's always the best part. And now, if you're a Grammarpalooza subscriber, you can also send a voice memo. I send texts with fun facts a couple times a week, and you can also ask me questions. It's a great way to support the show. To sign up, visit joinsubtext.com/grammar or text hello to 917-540-0876. Grammar Girl is a quick and dirty tips podcast. Thanks to marketing associate Davina Tomlin, ad operations specialist Morgan Christianson, digital operations specialist Holly Hutchings, marketing assistant Kamryn Lacy, audio engineer Nathan Semes, and director of podcasts Brannan Goetschius. And I'm Mignon Fogarty, better known as Grammar Girl. That's all. Thanks for listening.